Morning, everyone, and welcome to my speech. I was telling His Excellency that there are two events that are started on time with President Coup of my speech. That was His Excellency Dramani Mahama and President Gambia, who similarly is a long-time president. So it's a privilege to have you here today. If I might just say a few words and give Bob Collymore a chance to say something as well, and then I'll do the official introduction. I'd like to thank the Norfolk today, and Moshi, I hope, is somewhere, for making this available for us today. Thank you, Moshi. I'd like to thank Bob from Safaricom for giving us the live feed so anyone anywhere in the world can watch this presentation today. Safaricom and Bob have been fantastic supporters of MindSpeak, and I'm really deeply grateful. And I know he never wants to put up his banners, but let me be the banner for him today and say whenever we've needed his assistance, he's come through. And I really still think that, you know, people now talk about over-the-top broadcasting. We were doing it many years ago at MindSpeak. So thank you, Bob, for that as well. Before I turn to Bob, I'd just like to also give a shout out to Fanice. Where's Fanice, please?
Hi.
Where are you? Do you want to stand up, Fanice? Thank you. Fanice, I meet a lot of people who come into my office and say, let's do this and let's do that. And Fanice came into my office and said, let's host His Excellency John Dramani Mahama. And here we are hosting him a very few short days after that. And that is my really highest recommendation, point one. Fanice Mogake is the founder and CEO of Ion Africa, a Pan-African organization highlighting development across the continent, showcasing investment opportunities across sub-Saharan Africa. She is an alumnus of the Harvard Kennedy School, and she also has a degree in sociology communications from Massey University, New Zealand, and a postgraduate certificate in public policy from the University of Southern California. She has long supported integration, trade, development at both her professional and in her personal capacity in Africa. She has worked at the UN, seconded to the Kenyan government, has advised governments around Africa at high levels, including the presidency, as you can see, on development, political, and other strategic issues. I cannot recommend her highly enough, and I say that from the bottom of my heart. Well done, and thank you. Before I go into a formal intro, I'd like to give Mr. Collymore the opportunity to say a few words. And I know Bob gets annoyed with me because I always cite this, but let me cite it again, because I still think it is the way to... Bob Collymore has presided, just for you all to know, in the time he's been CEO of Safaricom, over about an 800% return to shareholders. I follow numbers all over the world, and I can tell you that there are very few companies where you could have put your money and achieved this kind of return. It's less than zero. He is in the top 0.5 percentile of worldwide returns over that period. And that is what you call an outlier. But Bob actually is much more than just the numbers. He's been a friend of mine since the day he came here, and I thoroughly appreciate the friendship. And more than that, it's been a learning process for me. Bob is running, you know, a very complex business. He's having to navigate multiple environments simultaneously, and his ability to do all those things has really been something which I think few people have truly recognized, and I would like to recognize it at this point. Bob, can I turn over to you?
Thank you. Your Excellency, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Ali Khan, you're so tall, it's unnecessary to be quite that tall. When I last took the MindSpeak stage back in November, I touched on the forces that are beginning to shape our world, and in particular, talked about how leadership is under threat. Leadership is not under threat from an individual or another political party, but not even from a tribe. Quite simply, the world is actually losing faith in leaders. More and more people are feeling they're left behind, and this is due to a number of factors. Economic insecurity, uncertain economies, globalization. all of which have left the public very angry and very fearful. And we're facing a world in the midst of momentous change. And there have been some pretty visible signs. Some were shocked about the election of Donald Trump, and we talked about that at the last Mindspeak. Many didn't really fully understand that his election revealed the deep distrust that had built up in America against leadership. There are mounting concerns about political upheaval in both developed and developing economies around the world. And according to the Edelman Trust Barometer, trust in all institutions, whether it be government, it be businesses, media, NGOs, trust has fallen dramatically, with the majority of respondents saying that the system has failed them. And there are significant factors, as Kenya moves towards its election later this year. We're on the cusp of our most productive years as we become a mature democracy here in Kenya. And at the same time, we risk leaving even more people behind because of selective developments which target only those who are in favor. It's very clear that over the next 6 months, the right decisions will have to be made by our leaders, which is why it's an honor today to hear His Excellency's view on leadership today. President Mahama is a respected historian, writer, communication specialist, and farmer, who is also known for both his love of music, and for those of you who enjoy the trance-like music of Fela Kuti and indeed Fema, he is a great fan. He also has a tremendous sense of humor. He's known for his straight shooting style and his passion for speaking out for the underprivileged, not just when he was the president, but throughout his life. He once said that we must retool ourselves to prepare for the challenges that we already face to maintain our position in the global economy. As we listen to His Excellency talk today, we must adopt the same attitude and retool ourselves for future challenges. It is a deep honor to have His Excellency here today, and indeed, as Ali Khan has forced me to be on the stage today, Ali Khan.
Bob took me back to his mind speak when he started off with the Trilobites. Was it the Tribalites or the Trilobites?
Trilobites.
And you don't have to look that up because it really was interesting. Just quickly, if I might just touch on, you know, the world in 2016 was kind of unputdownable and a white knuckle ride. We find ourselves at the beginning of 2017 in a world that feels entirely different to that we started off with in 2016. We've had Brexit, we've had Donald Trump, and it feels as if it's all about something that a philosopher called Paul Virilio said, the message is not exactly the medium, but above all, the ultimate speed of its propagation. And we now have a president in America where, frankly, most people look at his Twitter account before they look at the news to try and find out what's happening. Against this international backdrop, Sub-Saharan Africa is in fact growing at the slowest rate for 20 years. A lot is to do with Nigeria and South Africa because it makes up half of Sub-Saharan Africa and both economies are slow. And it feels, Your Excellency, a little bit different to the time when everywhere you turned you'd see an Africa Rising banner. And I think in the environment we're now in is when, you know, the tough have to get going. We've got to make it work in a different environment and we've got to deal with different challenges. Whilst, you know, everyone on social media keeps saying Africa's not a country, and it isn't, there's so many different things happening. In particular, one can feel, coming out of West Africa, a trend change in terms of politics. His Excellency John Mahama, Gina was reminding me, called the incoming president within minutes of the result being announced, much quicker than any other person had done anywhere else in the world. And then this incredible intervention that the president was involved with in the Gambia, and I'm sure he's going to touch on it, but it signals that, you know, things are changing. And I'm looking forward very much to hearing from him about that. Before I introduce His Excellency, I'd just like to mention a few things. This week, I've immersed myself in Dramani. I've been reading his book, My First Coup d'Etat. I've been listening to Fela Kuti. I liked Aphrodisiac best. I like that Aphrodisiac album the best. Yeah. I was reading My First Coup d'Etat and felt in my gut, in this book, the president describes he was a boarder at school, as was I. And in the description, the school term ends and no one has come to pick him up. And as a boarder, when you're a young boy at a boarding school, that's probably the worst feeling because you've been waiting and waiting for the end of term. And that description was so powerful, Your Excellency, I will not forget it. Then going, looking for his house in town, seeing the soldiers surround it, having to think on their feet and move and go turn around and get out of there because they weren't sure what the circumstances are. Another piece of the book, which I just want to touch on quickly, is a description of a monthly dance in the village under the full moon. And I think you called it an electric moon. And it was beautifully described, and how the village would get together in an old type of living, which His Excellency said went the day they got electricity. That whole style of the village disappeared. Listening to Jackson 5 after all these years, because His Excellency delivered an extraordinary speech at Unga many years ago, which I went to read. And in that, he quotes the words of, is it Heal the World?
Heal the World, Michael.
Heal the World, and says, you know, why can't we get back to that kind of mood where we all felt part of a big group and we were all trying to improve everybody else? And as I was reading, I was thinking, you know, why am I enjoying this so much? And I think it's because, in a way, it was a period which I remember. This was my youth as well. And then I realized it was shorn of the colonial talk. It was a born free generation, people who were thinking slightly differently. And that was the mood I really enjoyed. And Your Excellency, I've got to just throw in a couple of things before I come off the podium. I have my two agendas. I told you that I'm visualizing them. Yeah. One of those agendas is to take Mindspeak Pan-African, and I hope we can work together, maybe to even ask President Adama Barrow to be our guest with you there, I hope.
Okay.
Amongst others. The pressure's on. And on that note, I would just like to briefly give you an introduction. His Excellency doesn't need an introduction, but just to give you a brief one, and then we've got a short video before His Excellency speaks. John Dramani Mahama is a Ghanaian politician, served as the President of Ghana from 2012 July to 7th January 2017, previously served as Vice President of Ghana from 2009 to 2012, and took office as president on 24th July 2012, following the death of his predecessor, John Atta Mills. He said then about John Atta Mills, "This is the saddest day in our nation's history. Tears have engulfed our nation and we are deeply saddened and distraught, and I'm personally devastated. I've lost a father, I've lost a friend, I've lost a mentor and a senior comrade. Ghana is united in grief at this time for our departed president." President Mahama has operated on the global stage, as we all know. He is married to Lordina Mahama, has three children Farida, Sharaf, and Jesse. He is a Christian, born and raised as a Presbyterian, now a member of the Assemblies of God. But this is what I like. His family is multi-faith, consisting of Christians and Muslims. And I think there you have an example of what we should all be thinking. There is no difference between any of us. We're all human beings. We're on the same journey. And congratulations for that. Before I turn over, I'll just give you the first piece from the book, My First Coup d'Etat. He recalls in its first chapter the day in 1966 when he learned of the ousting of Ghana's founding president Kwame Nkrumah in a military coup. "When I look back on my life, it's clear to me that this moment marked the awakening of my consciousness. It changed my life and influenced all the moments that followed. Today we have an opportunity to hear that journey from that moment in His Excellency Mahama's life. It is a privilege today to have you here.
Thank you, Ali.
And it's been a privilege to meet you and to immerse myself in the story of Mahama. Thank you.
His Excellency John Dramani Mahama was born in 1958 in Damongo in northern region Ghana. His early education was attained in Accra, Ghana, and his secondary education attained in Tamale, northern Ghana. He studied history at the University of Ghana, followed by a postgraduate diploma in communication studies. He further went on to study social psychology in Moscow, after which he worked as information, culture and research officer at the Embassy of Japan. After this, he worked as international relations, sponsorship communications and grants manager at anti-poverty NGO, Plan International at their Ghana country office. Between 1992 and 2009, he served as an elected member of parliament, Boli Bamboi constituency, located in the northern region of Ghana. In 1997, he was appointed deputy minister of communications, became a founding member of the Ghana AIDS Commission, and served as a chairman of the National Economic Management Team. In 1998, he was appointed Minister of Communications and served as the Chairman of the National Communications Authority. While in Parliament, he served as the Minority Parliamentary Spokesman for Communications between 2001 and 2004, and later the Minority Spokesman for Foreign Affairs in 2005. In 2012, he was awarded an honorary doctorate in the field of public administration by Ekiti State University in Nigeria and also studied as a visiting scholar at the Johns Hopkins University. Former President Mahama was a member of the team of international observers selected to monitor Zimbabwe's parliamentary elections. He was the chairperson of the West African Caucus during his tenure as a member of the Pan-African Parliament, having also served as a member of the UNDP Advisory Committee on conflict resolution. In 2008, he was chosen by late President John Atta Mills as running mate for Vice President of Ghana. The election was successful and His Excellency John Dramani Mahama became one of the most active and vocal Vice Presidents that Ghana has ever seen. While Vice President, he became a published author with the release of his book, My First Coup d'Etat. The book received raving reviews during and after his book tours in New York, Texas and Los Angeles. After the demise of President Atta Mills, John Mahama duly took over as Ghana's president from July of 2012. In the same year, he ran a spirited campaign and won Ghana's 2012 presidential elections, effectively becoming the first Ghanaian president born after Ghana's independence. His Excellency John Mahama's presidency was characterized by a burgeoning of infrastructural development all across Ghana, alongside a rapid increase and improvement of social interventions such as providing school uniforms, sandals and books for school children, the school feeding program, the National Health Insurance Scheme, the Livelihood Empowerment Against Poverty program. Education and health reforms were a key cornerstone witnessed by 47 new senior high schools and upgrading of 7 polytechnics into technical universities. This was aimed at ensuring a skilled and relevant workforce for Ghana. New hospitals were built and old ones were re-equipped all across Ghana. He led with the mantra, changing lives and transforming Ghana, and was revered for his ability to maintain a stable and secure Ghana. The result was robust investment and recognition as the second largest economy in West Africa. On the international scene, he served as chairperson of ECOWAS between 2014 and 2015. One of his major achievements during this time was managing to steer the sub-region successfully out of the Ebola crisis. At the United Nations, he was nominated as co-chair of a group of 16 eminent Sustainable Development Goals, SDGs, advocates to support the UN Secretary General in his efforts to generate momentum and commitment to achieve the SDGs by 2030. He has been awarded the Great Cross of National Order of the Benin Republic, the dignity of Grand Cross of the National Order of Côte d'Ivoire, and was made an Honorary Doctor of Law by the Aberdeen University in Scotland. In late 2016, he was nominated co-chair in sub-regional committee mediating the Gambian crisis that followed after the Gambian elections. Former President Mahama received global praise for showing immense political maturity as he handed over to his successor. This indeed was a precedent set for all political leaders, a great step towards democratic consolidation in Africa. Going forward, former President John Mahama has stated that he will be actively involved in sub-regional, continental and international matters. It has been said that just like Osagyefo Dr. Kwame Nkrumah, generations to come will live and witness the benefit from the Mahama legacy.
Thank you very much. Let me thank Ali for this kind invitation to speak at this event. It came at short notice, and of course, he has revealed the architect of it all, Fanice. She mentioned to me that there was this event that is held monthly, and since I had joined the ranks of retired presidents and didn't really know what to do with the excessive time that I suddenly had on my hands, why don't I take the opportunity and come and speak at this event? And so we got in touch with Ali, a phone call, and the rest is history. Here I am. Thank you very much for the kind invitation. Good morning. And it's a real pleasure and an honor to be here in Nairobi with all of you today. I'm quite grateful for the opportunity to share some thoughts on democracy in general and democracy in our beloved continent, Africa in particular. I'd like to begin by telling you a story. It's a story that I've told many times in my life and have even written about. It's about an event that took place several decades ago. Yet despite the many times that I have told the story, it somehow feels more urgent and relevant now. My father, the late Mr. E. Mahama, was a member of parliament and a minister in the government of Dr. Kwame Nkrumah, Ghana's first president. In February of 1966, when that government was overthrown in a coup d'etat, my father was placed in detention, where he was kept for the greater part of 1 year. I was 7 years old at the time. After my father's release, he tried to stay as far away from politics as possible. He devoted his time to being a farmer and a father. Like so many African nations during that time, Ghana had begun what would turn into a cycle of coup d'etats that ushered in one military dictator after another. My dad was a fierce believer in democracy. He had tremendous disdain for dictators. But more than any of that, he loved his country and he wanted Ghana to succeed. In 1972, when Colonel Ignatius Kutu Achampong came into power as a result of a coup d'etat, he introduced some radical policies, most notably the one he devised to deal with Ghana's enormous national debt, and was named simply in the Akan language, Yentia, which translated from Akan means "we won't pay." That was his answer to the debt, "we won't pay." Another policy introduced by Colonel Achampong was Operation Feed Yourself. This encouraged Ghanaians to grow what they consumed. It was highly successful, not least of all because it increased morale and fostered a great sense of national pride. There were a number of other successful policies, all implemented under the umbrella of seven fundamental governing principles. The first one of which was Ghanaians were one people with one country, one heritage, and one destiny. My father, like so many other Ghanaians, was impressed. Despite the fact that Colonel Achampong had come into power by way of a coup d'etat, my father was hopeful that, unlike a typical coup maker, he might have Ghana's best interests at heart instead of his own. In fact, my father was so impressed and hopeful that he sat down and wrote Colonel Achampong a letter telling him exactly that. In that letter, my father also decided to dispense a bit of political wisdom. He advised Colonel Achampong to remember to leave when the applause is loudest. It took almost no time at all after my father had sent that letter for the military officers to arrive at our home and carry him off to the nearest barracks for interrogation and possible detainment. Somehow that little piece of advice he had given had been interpreted as a possible threat. He was not formally detained, but in that experience, he learned an indispensable lesson about democracy, a lesson he made sure to pass on to me. Democracy is non-negotiable. Certainly, all democracies are not alike. It is not a one-size-fits-all system. Nevertheless, regardless of the form that it takes, each democracy at its core is a system of governance that is fueled by the will of the people. I began by saying that I felt this story of my father and the letter he wrote and the subsequent lesson that he taught me about democracy was especially relevant now, and I wish to explain why. Last December, elections were held in Ghana. I had served for 4 years as president and was seeking re-election. It was a long and hard-fought contest, at the end of which the people of Ghana had their say by way of the ballot. During the course of the campaign that led up to the elections, there was one question I was asked a number of times that always bristled me. And the question was, if you do not win, will you concede? Obviously, each time my answer was yes. But I was always left a bit perplexed, because what other answer was there to give? Imagine my surprise when, around the same period that I was being routinely asked that question, I watched the final debate of the United States presidential campaign, and the same question was posed to the candidates. One said yes, and the other said, I'll look at it at the time. Africa's relationship with democracy has been a rocky one. Some have even argued that African societies, many of which prior to colonialism were once feudal, are not traditionally ideal for a democratic form of governance. On its surface, the theory might have seemed credible immediately following the wave of independence that swept through the continent when our nations were being ruled by the likes of Idi Amin and Mobutu Sese Seko. These were not rulers who cared about applause. They were rulers who had no intentions of ever leaving and relinquishing power. And more important, they were rulers who had little, if any, consideration for the citizens of their countries. And the continent suffered as a result. We lost many of our intellectuals, our artists, our doctors, our engineers, our poets, our scientists, our innovators, left in droves. Economies were crippled by mass corruption, and the significant loss of human resource, so much so that many families, societies, and nations were kept afloat by the remittances being sent back home by citizens in the diaspora. That period of time is known as the lost decades. They were dismal times, and they seemed never ending. But then something shifted. Progress started taking place. It happened gradually over a period of time. So gradually, in fact, that when the world finally took notice, it had already gained momentum. And so this progress was made to seem sudden, almost meteoric. Africa rising, it was labeled, and was treated as a new phenomenon. From seemingly out of nowhere, several African countries were among the top 10 fastest growing economies in the world. Not only were Africans who'd been living in the diaspora returning home, Westerners who were relocating to the continent as well to take advantage of the burgeoning business opportunities in all fields. IT, communications, and the service industries were expanding at a rapid pace. African literature, film, and arts were experiencing an international renaissance. In my capacity as vice president and then as president, I attended several conferences with the theme Africa Rising. The focus of most of these conferences was, as you might imagine, primarily economic. And the substance of the discussions at these conferences was more often than not how and where these shifts were taking place on the African continent and what the implications were for the rest of the world. There was rarely any talk of why. Why were these shifts happening? What was at the roots of this undeniable progress that we were seeing? The rest of the world has often held a strictly binary view of Africa. We're either failing or we're succeeding, rising to great heights or falling to the lowest depths of destitution, disease, and societal dysfunction. Rarely are we afforded the full range of motion that growth experiences that nation building requires. Rarely are we afforded the full range of motion that growth experiences that nation building requires. So it is important to stop and investigate the reason why this progress that was labeled Africa Rising started taking place. What inspired it? It is my belief that the more we investigate the reasons for all the promise of prosperity that now exists before us as a continent, that we will find that at least one of those reasons is the spread of democracy. Today, majority of African countries hold regular elections. There are at least 25 of the 54 countries that hold elections regularly that are widely determined to be free and fair. Even the countries whose political situations are regarded with skepticism, the countries whose democracies are not considered matured because of the dominance of one political party or because a single president has ruled for decades, even those countries are holding elections. Though, to be fair, the transparency and fairness of those elections are often held in doubt. But it's a beginning, a point of entry into a process that will eventually give way to the rule of law. How do I know this? Because we've all been there before, nearly each and every one of the countries on this continent. Let's take, for example, the recent events in the Gambia, a country that has for years been inching its way into democracy. On the 1st of December 2016, elections were held. President Yahya Jammeh, who came to power in 1994 as a result of a coup d'etat, was defeated by the opposition candidate Adama Barrow. This was not the first time President Jammeh had stood for re-election. Elections were held in Gambia in 1996, in 2001, in 2006, and in 2011. And in each of these elections, Jammeh was declared the winner. With each exercise, the citizenry grew more comfortable with the prospect of having their votes counted, of having their voices heard. And as the saying goes, there is strength in numbers. Eventually, those numbers became undeniable. Perhaps President Jammeh realized this when he initially accepted the results of the election. But then after about a week, he recanted his concession. This turn of events created a dangerous impasse in a period that should have marked the nation's embrace of another hallmark of democracy, a smooth transition of power. It would have been a transition from 22 years of dictatorship to the dawn of what could well become an authentic democracy. It would have been a victory for the people of Gambia, a new beginning full of possibilities for change. I was requested by regional governing body ECOWAS, the Economic Community of West African States, to participate in two missions to Banjul to remonstrate with President Jammeh to accept the will of the Gambian people. I'm fairly certain that I was included in the group that made the two missions because I had only recently lost the elections of 7th December in Ghana. and had within 48 hours of the poll called my opponent, President Akufo-Addo, and congratulated him in advance of the declaration of the results by the Electoral Commission. It is one thing for a sitting leader, someone still ensconced in the power of a presidency, to explain to the loser of an election why he must concede. It is quite another to hear those same words from a leader who himself has just lost an election and conceded an electoral defeat. Neither instance made a difference. Our words fell on deaf ears. With just hours to go until his mandate expired, President Jammeh declared a state of emergency, extending his rule for 90 days. ECOWAS responded by sending in an intervention force to uphold the will of the Gambian people. Since it was obvious that his forcible removal was imminent, President Jammeh agreed to cede power and to go into temporary exile in Equatorial Guinea. There's a fine line between respecting the sovereignty of a nation and recognizing the damage that a dictatorship poses to not only the citizens of that nation, but also to the residents in their neighboring countries and consequently to the entire sub-region. I believe that ECOWAS walked that line quite admirably. And in so doing, a statement was made about the collective vision of West Africa's political future. Not so long ago, such a thing would never have happened. In my father's era of politics, regional governing bodies such as ECOWAS and the EAC and even the African Union were quite often referred to as toothless bulldogs because no matter how loudly they barked, they did not bite. This was dictated by the internationally recognized policy of non-interference in the internal affairs of other nations. But times have changed. Africa has changed, and she will continue to keep changing. In my father's day, the United States was the example of a true great democracy. It was what so many African citizens emulated and wished for their own countries. What American president could ever bully and intimidate a regular citizen the way Colonel Achampo had bullied and intimidated my father, simply because he wrote a letter in which he spoke his mind about what he thought was in the best interest of his nation? Today we're realizing that the democracy that exists in the United States cannot and perhaps should not exist in the same form for all of us. Each country has to find the type of democracy that best fits the needs of its citizenry. Each democracy has to be shaped by the will of the people. Each democracy must be shaped by their collective voice. The more we allow that to happen on this continent, the more our businesses will flourish and the more our people will prosper. And let me add, there is no shortcut to democratic consolidation and economic prosperity. We need to work at it. We need to stay the course of structural reform. I recognize that we have an increasingly youthful population that is impatient to see change and experience prosperity in their lives. But the reality is that nobody possesses a magic wand to create change and progress with a wish of abracadabra. In these critical times, as the nations in the so-called Western world allow fear, religious intolerance, xenophobia, ethnic and racial prejudice to move them into isolation, into closing borders and building walls, what is at stake for us here in Africa is our very survival. We know the value not only of our natural resources, but also of our human resources. We've seen how our brothers and sisters, our daughters and sons have helped to shape the progress in the diaspora. We must continue to encourage their return. We must continue to inspire and empower our citizens who are already here. We must work together, all of us, to realize the prosperity we desire. Political stability and the rule of law are not merely a foundation for prosperity, They are also a protection against the looming threat of terrorism, the senseless violence that has already claimed too many African lives. When the last military dictatorship came into power in Ghana, my father fled the country. He lived in self-imposed exile for much of the remainder of his life. When I was elected president in 2012, I wished more than anything that my father had been alive and in Ghana to see not just what had become of me, but what had also become of the country he so loved. During the inauguration, during which I was sworn in as president, there was a point at which I just sat and listened to the applause. It made me remember those fateful words my father had written in his letter: "Leave when the applause is the loudest." Throughout the course of my presidency, I have both been applauded and criticized. I was both revered and reviled. When you find yourself standing at the center of all that sound and fury, it is difficult to determine when it is indeed the loudest. I suppose that is why it's important that we leave it to history to determine our legacies. Last month, I attended the inauguration of President Akufo-Addo. When I exited my vehicle and my arrival was publicly announced at the Black Star Square, there was a loud round of applause. Again, I thought of my father and those words: "Leave when the applause is the loudest." Suddenly, I understood them in a way I had never understood them before. Democracy is not unlike soccer. It is a team sport. When the ball is in your possession, you do your best to move it forward. But then you must inevitably pass that ball to the next player and wish for him or her to make the best in making progress, because the victory that comes is not claimed by you or any of the other players. The victory that comes always belongs to the team. And in a democracy, the team is always the people, the citizens of the country, and in a broader sense, the region and the continent that is your home. Leave when the applause is the loudest. I thank you for your kind attention.